Welcome. I'm joined today by Julie Cogin. Julie is an associate professor in the School of Management at the Australian School of Business and an expert in the area of work design. Julie, thank you for joining me today.
It's great to be here.
Julie, can you tell us about some of the latest thinking and groundbreaking research that's happening in the area of work design?
As noted in the course material, there have been changes in demographic characteristics of the workforce. Many of the examples in the unit relate to gender, ethnicity, or the ageing population. However, my research on the multi-generational workforce suggests that age diversity is an important issue and has a significant impact on job design and motivation. So specifically, I was interested in uncovering whether some of the hype associated and attributed to generational groups was in fact correct. So I went about looking at the work values of age groups and generational cohorts. So I must admit, I went out to prove that these differences were largely the result of life cycle. So what I mean by that is generation-wise will eventually adopt the characteristics of baby boomers and traditionalists. So I admit, Markus, that I was incorrect. Not only did I found substantial differences between age groups, that the work values tended to remain fairly stable over time. There was also increased conflict in the workplace as a result of generational differences, which is no real surprise given that there could be four generations all working together. And I attributed this conflict to be about different perceptions in regard to work ethic. So not only do generation-wise look different, with many having piercings, tattoos, and electronic gadgets attached to their bodies, that they think and act differently as well. First, there's the notion of job mobility and tenure, which is markedly different across groups. So Ys will change jobs quickly and often if their needs are not met. They'll certainly make a commitment to an organisation, a long-term commitment, but this could mean 1 year. So Ys have particular skill sets. So if firms want to retain these skills or they want to target the market of Ys, they need to adjust the way that they design jobs. So older generations tend to value longer tenure to firms and will hang around even if they're not satisfied or adequately challenged. So the main difference is that younger employees are more committed to their profession or career, and older workers have a stronger attachment to their firms, irrespective of whether that's justified or not. So Ys are the product of hard-working baby boomer parents. Baby boomers during the 80s worked longer hours than we'd ever seen before, often to cope with the huge interest rates, which were nearly at 20% in Australia. More often, we had both parents in the workplace. And at the same time, many firms embarked on downsizing initiatives, right-sizing, middle management massacres, whatever you want to call it. So the Ys saw their parents work really hard and dedicate their lives to an organisation, often making personal sacrifices, and then face these negative consequences. So Al Bandura, who I know students of MPO know and love, might predict that these shifts in employment patterns have influenced the work values of Generation Y employees and subsequently their behaviour.
Julie, what are some of the practical implications for managers and leaders of some of the things you talked about and the concepts that are covered in this unit?
So participants of MPO will be familiar with Hackman and Oldham's job characteristics model. One component of this model is that to enrich a job, employees need to experience meaningfulness in their work that will provide an outcome that is valuable to them. Not so different to some of the concepts of motivation. So to apply this model, managers should not assume that what Generation Ys value will be the same as what other cohorts value. So in my study, the most important work value for traditionalists and baby boomers was hard work, while for Ys, it was being able to balance work with leisure. Ys are certainly not going to work as many hours as older generations have in the past. Now, while flexible work practices have been in place for some time, there are problems in the way they are perceived, with the general view being they are designed for parents or for women. Other challenges are that those who take up flexible work options, thereby indicating visibly their desire for a personal life, can face negative judgments in relation to their commitment to a team or firm. However, it is only through such programs that some of the major hurdles of generation differences can be overcome. So the goal, which is a tough one, is to create conditions that both advance corporate objectives and fit with employee needs and preferences. So Ys live in the present and seek gratification of immediate needs. This has implications for the types of rewards available and when they're offered, training and development, and the frequency of communication and feedback. So unlike previous generations who have in large part grown accustomed to the annual performance review, Generation Y is going to respond more positively to receiving much more regular feedback and recognition, with progressive rather than annual rewards built in. So practices that will retain older workers should also be considered in line with their strong orientation towards hard work. Organisations may wish to configure work arrangements to facilitate a gradual exit. Mentoring opportunities, or where their tacit knowledge, experience and wisdom is drawn upon, also tends to be meaningful with this group. So in summary, managers need to engage in more age-orientated job design and decision making if they wish to remain competitive in attracting and retaining the best people. The challenge is to be creative and accommodating different needs of generational cohorts while still watching the bottom line.
Julie, thank you very much for joining me today and speaking to me.
It was my pleasure. Thanks, Markus.